Okay, I've gone ahead and disassembled the spindle assembly and brought it over to the table here. And I'm going to show you the difference between the latest changes that have been made and as opposed to the spindle that was created for the TAG spindle housing itself. Originally, this is the design that we ended up with, but we also ended up with the spindle shaft that was relatively small. And in order to increase that, I was wanting to change the bearings so that the inside OD or ID was just a bit larger and more beefy for my spindle. But I couldn't find any bearings that would take the place of that, that would give me the satisfaction of having a larger shaft. So in order for me to be able to do that, I had to go ahead and increase the size of the bearing. In order to increase the size of the bearing, it had to incorporate a little bit more material than what was allowed on the original TAG extrusion. So I used 3x3, the solid stock aluminum, and built a new spindle housing with a 2-inch bearing that's rated for 10,000 RPM. That gave me quite a bit of beef on my on the shaft of my spindle. So this is the new spindle that is being, well, that's going to be the end of it actually, because I think this is about as good as you can get. What we had before was we had a spindle that was relatively beefy that had 8 balls that were under pressure by a 10-pound spring, and it held well. It did a good job, but it lacked a little bit. The first thing it lacked in was rigidity here. I was kind of sensing that there was a little vibration because it wasn't as rigid as it needed to be. And also that the very characteristic of an end mill, the helical shape of the cutting edges, had a tendency of trying to pull on the tool holder in deeper cuts, so that, not that it could pull it out, but that it could chatter just a little bit when it loosened up under pressure. So to combat that, we went ahead, we didn't eliminate the fact that we've got 8 10-pound pressure balls in 8 different locations. We kept that. There's reasons for that. But instead of making that the primary source or the primary holding mechanism, we also included with that 4 flyweights that operate on the RPM of the spindle. So when the spindle RPM increases to, let's say, an RPM of 1,000 or over, in fact, I'm going to prove it to you here in just a little bit, that it takes 1,000 RPMs for these flyweights to engage. As the spindle increases in speed, the pressure of the pins against the tool holder keep it in one location without worrying about the pressure of a ball under spring pressure. So even though this doesn't have any balls in it right now, and obviously it's not engaging or locking in place, I can lock it in place by engaging these artificially and it won't come out. Something else that I wanted to show as well, because I know this is an evaluation of the spindle to show you how it was created and why certain things were done. I've got 4 of these stop dogs on the very bottom, and 26 or 28, I can't remember, but 26 hole locations on the very top of the flange of the tool holder. And the reason for that is to keep it from sliding sideways when the tool holder is engaged in the spindle. Now, there's only 2 of these pins that'll engage at one time. So I think, if I'm not mistaken, the amount of angle, or the amount of distance in angle, is about 4 degrees before it engages the next one. If you can see, this one right here is not engaged at this location, but if it moves over one more, it is. It's not engaged there, but that one is. It's engaged there, but that one's not. So that gives you a very minimal amount of movement so that the tool holder doesn't slide and gall up on the inside of your spindle. It's obvious these are prototypes. They're made out of aluminum, and I'm still unclear as to what the material is going to be for the final product. But we'll go ahead and go over to the lathe right now. We'll show you what it looks like when this is at 1,000 RPM, and the simple fact that we know that it's going to lock, because I'm going to show you how it locks with the tool in it without the ball locking mechanism holding it in. Okay, now we have the spindle mounted in the CNC lathe, and I'm going to gradually turn up the RPMs until I reach 1,000 RPMs. What you're going to see is you're going to see the actual pin and spring start to collapse, and the fly weights kind of make those disappear, and that's how we know when those pins are engaged. As you can still see the pin. As we increase at 480, 620, 720, 820, 900, and 1,000. Just to be safe, I'm going to bring it up to 1,200. Right now I'm at 1,200. I'm going to turn that off. And now we're going to go ahead and put a tool in. If you notice, when I put the tool in, because we have no ball locks in here, the tool just simply comes out. So I'm going to put the tool in, turn it on, and just to prove and to show that the pins will lock this in place, it'll lock in place after I release my hand. When I turn that off, it should pop out.